Thank you very much, sir, for yielding. Speakers in the house spend all their time getting members who yield for each other. So here is a speaker who's setting a good example by yielding to someone else. I know you are a young speaker. It's a challenging job, and I hope you do it well, and I hope you make a much fairer speaker than, unfortunately, the speaker of our Lok Sabha these days, who seems to be no more than a BJP spokesperson, unfortunately. I used twice, unfortunately, there. Having said that, I'm here to remember an old valued colleague. You said good things about my editing, India Today Malayalam. I must be a rare person who edited publications of which I didn't know ABC or alphabet. So this is India Today Tamil, Telugu, Malayalam, and we launched Gujarati. Gujarati, at least you can figure out a little bit from the script, but not any of the other languages. And I was doing it in addition to my job at in English in India Today. And for me, initially, it looked very far and looked like not a very important part of my job because I was still focused on my stories and stuff that I was doing in the main magazine, as we used to call it. But soon enough, I began to learn a lot from my colleagues in languages. But more importantly, it helped me acquire the humility to understand that much more substantive journalism was being done in India's languages than in English, because we tend to be focused only on English, and we think this is our universe. You wanted me to speak about the state of the media. I can speak about the state of the media, and I can begin from anywhere. But since you mentioned ISRO, you mind if I take this one off? It's a bit warm for this. I'll go back to when I land, it'll be 3 degrees in Delhi, so I need some cover. See, if something like the ISRO spy case had broken out today, just imagine what would have happened. Many of you are of the age group that was around and that knew what happened in that spy case. Many of you, I notice, are people who were either not born then or must have been too small to know what's going on. This started in 1994. The last major story I handled in India Today, because I left India Today in 1995. Everybody said that this scandal had taken place. And the stories coming out, unfortunately, from Kerala press were very dire. They were eyewitness accounts and quote-unquote eyewitness accounts. I was passing by Nambi Narayanan's or Shashidharan's house, Shashikumaran's house, and I saw a fire inside, and I stopped to look, and I found that he was burning secret documents. Now, how can somebody on the street figure out that somebody was burning something, and that too documents, and that too secret documents? But this folklore was believed, and very eminent people, late T.V.R. Shenoy, many others, people who we respected in Delhi, and who we were in awe of, not just bought into this, but actually actively encouraged it. It also became a Congress versus CPM thing. CPM was in power at that time, if I remember correctly. Narasimha Rao was in power in Delhi. Narasimha Rao, by this time, was weakening. Kanakaran was in power, yes. Narasimha Rao was in power in Delhi. And in any case, there was no sympathy for these scientists. Everybody was competing, as it happened, say, with 2G. Everybody was competing, send these fellows to jail now. And then we began to get some information that there were some doubts in the story, there were some holes in the story, there were then mega holes in the story, then there were such big holes in the story that actually it was a story of a self-goal. That by this making this a scandal, we had actually blown a very important covert operation that government of India was running at that point, that was to get cryogenic technology from the Soviets at that point in unmarked aircraft which were coming into Trivandrum and landing and bringing stuff which was otherwise denied to India because of sanctions. But because the story was broken like, oh, these unidentified aircraft are flying into Trivandrum and these scientists are going and they are getting packets of money and they are handing over secrets to them. Anyway, to cut the long story short, we challenged it. We paid the price for challenging it. My first frequent visits to Trivandrum. In fact, I've never spent more than 18 hours in Trivandrum, and I'm fated that way. My first few visits to Trivandrum were actually to come and attend court proceedings because some of the policemen had filed criminal defamation cases against us. And I must say, one of those visits was very inspirational because, you know, every time I used to say, you know, I have to go all the way to Trivandrum, I had to suffer two long flights. And those days, I don't think flights have gotten much better even now from Delhi. Most flights still come hopping. I also came hopping at Bombay today. But you said, like, all the way to Trivandrum with a lawyer, then come back the next day. It was just a waste of time. And then I saw these two Maldivian women who thanked me in the court for standing by them. And then I realized that every court hearing, they were brought in a broken, rickety police bus from a prison, I think, Thrissur or someplace, about 250 kilometers away. And I said, if these poor women from a distant, tiny, very poor country can suffer this, this is nothing. I come with a lawyer, I fly business class, I stay in a good hotel, I go back, what's the big deal? And then also the questions from Trivandrum Press used to be hostile, that why are you, aren't you guilty that you have spoken against national interest to us? Now, imagine what would have happened if such a so-called quote-unquote scandal had broken out now. Now, there would have been such noise because today media is run purely, it was even then run by herd mentality, but today this herd is much larger. This herd is also on many platforms, in many media. This herd is on coming from your TV screens. This herd is screaming at you from your phones. This herd is screaming at you from radio. This herd is screaming at you from podcasts. This herd is screaming at you on Twitter, Facebook, worst of all, WhatsApp, right? If at that point somebody could imagine that these people were burning documents, God knows what we imagine now. So the state of the media cannot be assessed or cannot be spoken about without talking about the essential changes in the media. The biggest change in the media is the revolution in platform technology. So something that took you, I mean, if you look at Delhi newspapers today, I don't know what it is here, they all say George Fernandez dead. Now, George Fernandez had been dead already this morning for 24 hours. So yesterday itself, not only did everybody know George Fernandez had died, everybody had read articles by everybody who worked with George Fernandez yesterday itself. So nobody has any interest. In old days, you would still need 24 hours. Now it doesn't even take 24 minutes. Second, editorial intermediation is now much less. Now people like us, even now, are called slow-moving, conservative, etc., because we think that journalism needs editorial intermediation. I don't believe in citizen journalism. I always say that if you get me citizen doctors and citizen lawyers, I will get you citizen journalists, because it's a profession that requires training, and editors have to be there to ask questions. How is it like this? How is it like this? That? How could it have happened? That has now vanished, because even in established media, people are in a great rush to publish, because if you don't move first, then you lose out. The third thing, the problem for journalists today, is that something that never existed. In the past, when newspaper was the only thing, or later when TV came, we did our stuff. If your spouse saw it, your significant other read it or heard you, or your landlord or your neighbor and fellow journalists, you were quite happy. Today, particularly if you're on the internet, Google tells you exactly how many people read you. So that is one, very bad for the egos of journalists. And second, it brings pressure on you. Are, I'm only being read by 500 people. So-and-so got read by 1 lakh people. Then you think, why was so-and-so read by 1 lakh people? Because so-and-so had the story. I had the story of delay in the purchase of anti-tank missiles for Indian Army. 500 readers. The other guy had a story about a snake marrying a tree. So that got 1 lakh viewers. So why don't I also do stories about snakes marrying trees? And then you see this going to the extreme. If you see, go back and open your internet now. Just Google Hindu Mahasabha, Aligarh. You will find a bizarre story. It's a woman dressed like a sadhvi with lots of paint on her forehead, with a pistol. A sizable woman with a pistol and few other people, all in saffron, applauding. And she's shooting from the pistol. And what is she shooting at? She's shooting at an effigy of Mahatma Gandhi. And when she fires from this fake pistol at Mahatma Gandhi's effigy, blood oozes out of the body. And then everybody applauds and they distribute prasad. And after that, they go and garland a picture of Nathuram Godse. Now, it's a terrible thing. It's a shameful thing. This country should die of embarrassment. But why has it been done? It's been all stage managed for cameras. Because some local channel, some local people wanted some story that will make national news. This woman, who's some chota mota, small-time worker of Hindu Mahasabha, she thought she should get national fame. Now, when she stages a drama like this, you cannot but give her national fame. Because if you don't give her national fame, someone else will give her national fame. And that pressure is what is now today. We are also sending a reporter tomorrow to profile this woman. But I also want to check out how this was organized. So this is the pressure on today's media. If you look at the larger division in the media today, essentially, most of the media is divided in two categories. I think word chamcha is known all over the country in every language. You know chamcha? Chamcha is a sycophant. Is the word morcha known all over the country? Morcha is a front, right? So a lot of the media is chamcha. They are just sucking up to whoever is in power, sycophants. A lot of the media is morcha. They just take up a cause or an idea or one politics and just position themselves there. So the space in the middle, depending on how you look at it, is either opening up or narrowing. I see it as opening up. I say, all right, the left is in its own bunkers. The right is in its own bunkers. They are both firing at each other. They are not to be confused by facts. So there's a large state in the middle which is not centrist, but which is a state where you can go by facts. So that's a factivist space. The danger is that when you are in that space, because the other two sides are hiding in their bunkers and firing freely at nobody in particular, when you are walking in the middle, you get hit by both sides. So this is a sniper's alley. So old-fashioned professional journalism has now become like a sniper's alley. You have to be very strong to be able to handle this, because it's very tempting right now to choose one side or the other. Because if you choose one side, then you know the other side will attack you, but this side will at least come to my defense. But if you don't do that, then both hit you. And what then happens is that today somebody may like what you are saying or writing or doing. Tomorrow when you say something they don't like, they say, "Are, make up your mind. Are you on this side or that side?" So for today's audiences also to understand that journalists don't have to be on this side or that side. Journalists can be on this side or that side in terms of their views, ideologies, positions. I believe in free economics. Somebody may believe in state-controlled economics. Right? I'm saying this in Trivandrum, left and Trivandrum. But that doesn't mean that if in a particular incident nobody dies, I say, oh, hundreds were killed. Because it suits my cause, I can't say that. But a lot of that has now begun to happen. Now, I don't want to take a lot of your time, and I know that we are constrained for time, but look at some of the more familiar examples. We had the stories of these mega scandals under UPA. Now, we all know they were scandals. They were genuine scandals. Spectrum was, 2G spectrum was a scandal. Coal mine allocation was a scandal. There were other scandals also. But look at the size that was mentioned. 2G spectrum was called a 1,76,000 crore spectrum. The gentleman who is from Kerala cadre of the IAS, Mr. Vinod Rai, who headed CAG at that point, he said 1,76,000 crore scandal. So we just asked a question that yes, in coal there was a scandal, in 2G there was a spectrum, But could the value of this much spectrum in 2007 be 2.21% of India's GDP? Could it be 12,000 crores more than India's entire defense budget? So look at the figure. I mean, then India's defense forces hold so much spectrum, they should just spend their spectrum and sell their spectrum and buy tanks, guns, submarines, aircraft carriers, 126 Rafales, why 36, right, et cetera, et cetera. But when you said that, the immediate thing was, you must be mixed up with the corrupt. So it became very difficult at that point to speak sanity. The other argument that many of us had was that Prevention of Corruption Act sends you for the same number of years in jail, whether you've stolen 100 crores or 1,76,000 crores. So 1,76,000 crores gives you the headline. But once you go with that kind of mythology in the court, you are bound to fix your case papers and you're bound to lose the case. And we know exactly what happened. CBI lost that case. Everybody got acquitted. Nobody has been punished for anything that happened with 2G. Not a paisa has been found. And what did the judge say in the case? The judge said, he wrote this in his order. He said, I come at 10 every morning. I sit till 6. Every morning I ask the CBI, give me some evidence of any money having been transferred. I wait. Nobody gives me any evidence. So what choice do I have but to let people go? So I think that is a very good example of how we in the media got really intimidated by the noise. The Anna movement, again, it's a counterintuitive thing to say. But again, we got caught in a herd mentality, and those of us who dared to question it were immediately called pro-corruption. Now it is very evident that the entire Anna movement was organized by the RSS, Vivekananda Foundation, etc., to build these obvious scandals into much bigger scandals than they were. And ultimately, objective was to bring the BJP to power, which is a legitimate objective in a democracy. Any party has the right to try and come to power and use all methods. But for journalists, it's important to be able to question these things on facts. But because of the noise, it became very difficult to question it. You have similar situations now. Say Rafale, for example. Now, if you don't like the BJP, whether Rafale is a scandal or not, or how big a scandal is Rafale, depends on whether you like the BJP or you don't like the BJP. Because these days, there's no like or dislike. Either you love the BJP or you hate the BJP. So if you love the BJP, nothing wrong happened. If you hate the BJP, then everything that Rahul Gandhi says, Rahul Gandhi has learned it from Anna Hazare and Narendra Modi. That, you know, you keep on repeating the same lie again and again and again and add a few zeros that makes better headlines. So Anil Ambani may have got 700 crores of offsets, which is also impossible to explain. Why should he get even those offsets? He makes nothing. But if Rahul Gandhi says 30,000 crores were given by Mr. Modi to his friend Anil Ambani, and if you say, no, it can't be 30,000 crores. Anil Ambani doesn't have the balance sheet to handle all this. Plus, this, no, you must be pro-corruption. So that is the big change right now in journalism. And that is what we face all the time. Because what do you do? When you say that facts are different from the folklore, on either side, I mean, even when I see Sabarimala coverage, I see it's a completely contrary views of this coverage coming out of, say, the press of the media of the left and media of the right. There is the super liberal media, which has one picture. There's another one. The other side, which has another picture. One side celebrates the poor woman being beaten up by her mother-in-law, right? The other side blames the BJP, Narendra Modi, for the mother-in-law beating up the daughter-in-law. So these are dilemmas that we face all the time. Now, as if all this was not enough, and today everybody has a voice. Everybody, you know, the moment, even if you tweet, the moment you say something halfway polarizing, you find that immediately there is reaction. And people don't say nice things to you if they disagree with you. I mean, I think to call you a dog is the nicest thing they can say to you. They usually say much more rude things to you. But further complicating all this is the economics of the media. For most of the news media in India, economics is now completely broken. India is a strange country. Around the world, it is the print media which is disappearing slowly, and new media are growing. TV is growing, digital is growing. India is a rare country where print media still remains quite robust, but everything else is suffering. And the most broken model in India, I'm telling you, is English television news. All television news, but most broken is the English television news. And I will in 2 minutes tell you why. When you open a newspaper, you find advertising from all kinds of things, including advertising for some dead body that's not being identified, or some bank statement, chairman statement, etc., etc. All kinds of advertising is there in newspapers, in print. But when you open TV channels at any given point of time, it is the same 10 or 12 products. There'll be Jioni, there'll be Vivo, there'll be Airtel, there'll be Idea, there'll be Vodafone, Jio will be everywhere, right? Then there'll be a couple of these fog, this deodorants, etc., etc. Whether you have an entertainment channel or a cricket channel or a news channel, you will find the same ads. What that means is, because a lot more people watch entertainment channels, all these products first have to advertise there at much higher prices. Then whatever little money they are left with, they then distribute among news channels. So news channels get very little money. And even among those news channels, English news channels, they look very big. But I can tell you that the most popular English channel, which is Arnab Goswami's English channel today, its total viewership will not be 5%, will not be 5% of the leading Malayalam channel. So English viewership is very small. So why should the advertiser pay more money for that? So that model is broken. Every English news channel in the country, every single English news channel is losing money. Barring three or four, every Hindi channel is losing money. I don't know how it is in the languages, but I think barring the leading channels in various languages, all the rest are losing money. So why are people running these channels? People are running these channels because people with other interests have acquired channels. They've either bought them or set them up, and they want to use these for other benefits. So real estate magnates have set up channels, mining barons have set up channels, other crooks have set up channels because they've all realized that media is a very cheap and very small business to set up. So that has further complicated the scenario for all of us. All of us are navigating this minefield. So there, when you find good people, people like the ones sitting here, I think many of you are journalists here, good people who are still doing good journalism, I think all of you, all of us deserve an award for bravery. But all I'd say is, as the example of Washington Post, New York Times, CNN has now shown, publications that Donald Trump calls fake every day, and every time he calls them fake, their numbers go up. As that example shows, if we continue doing classical, old-fashioned, accurate, trustworthy journalism, I think our audiences and our markets will still reward us. I will conclude on the note that, again, I am saying in a left capital, that there is no contradiction between the marketplace and good journalism. And markets are fair, and ultimately they will reward good journalism, because if that wasn't the case, then the Hindu would have shut down by now. It's a wonderful newspaper. So thank you very much. I wish I could have spoken longer, but I unfortunately cannot. Thanks for your patience.